difficulties already sorted. So hi. Welcome to D12 Med School for this month's installment. My name is Ryan. I'm a software developer here at D12. I've been here for about 2 years, just over 2 years now. And in that time, I've worked on a bunch of different projects, and several of those projects have made use of this neat thing we call hypermedia. So that's the really fast intro slide. Let's go to the next intro slide, mandatory overview slide. So we're going to start out talking today a little bit about kind of just what hypermedia is. It's not exactly an easy topic to lock down, but I'm going to do my best because I'm doing a presentation about it, so I'm probably able to do that. Then we're going to go, we're going to learn about what it is, and then we're going to need to stop talking about it and go over some traditional REST API architectures. The idea there, illustrating some of their benefits as well as some of their pitfalls, which will lead us hopefully very smoothly into the next section about how hypermedia can help us address some of those pitfalls. And then finally at the end, we'll take a little bit of a look at how we're using hypermedia here at D2L, some of our experiences, some of the things we've learned over the last 2 years-ish of using it, and that'll be the end. And then we'll have a set of questions and all that kind of stuff. So, what is this hypermedia thing, anyway? You've all come here presumably either knowing what it is, I see several people here, but know exactly what it is, so bear with me. If you don't, in creating this presentation, I tried to come up with a decent definition of it, and actually had a really hard time with it. The best way I could come up with it was, it's a way of representing data in a discoverable and highly linked way, which is extremely broad, but it kind of is extremely broad. Beyond that, a lot of what you're going to get into is just kind of implementation details anyway. Oh, this was actually the slide I was supposed to put, sorry. So discoverable, I can't see this, it is very small on this screen. Discoverable and connected. I'm going to be using these words, discoverable, connected, linked. I'm going to use them about 60,000 times during this presentation to hopefully drive home what I'm trying to get at here. Right. So I'm going to jump into what might seem like a weird example, especially for people who saw my previous version of this presentation. YouTube. This is YouTube. If you don't know, it's YouTube. What you're looking at here is, now you might be thinking to yourself, oh, I see. YouTube is a web page. Web pages are HTML. HTML is hypertext. And you're right. But that's not actually the point I'm trying to make here. The point I'm trying to make here is not about what's behind the page, but the page itself. YouTube is a video site. We can all agree on that. This is a resource on that site, a video, right? This is the representation of that resource as pertains to us on YouTube. So it's got a whole bunch of stuff there. You know, we have a title, we have duration, there's some buttons, all that kind of stuff. This resource has its own properties, like that title and duration. It also has related resources. So for example, Red Bull in this image, okay, you can't read it because, you know, projectors. This video is uploaded by Red Bull. Red Bull isn't a video. You can't play or pause a Red Bull. That doesn't make any sense. They're the uploader. So what they are in this context is a related resource. One might say they are a linked resource. There's also other things you can do on this page, like, hey, there's a bunch of links down at the bottom right there. We'll get to that in a second. But the idea here is that you've got a resource being presented to a video, and there's all sorts of links and all sorts of things you can click, and it's all very discoverable and it's all very connected. And it's doing that with three kind of key things. And this is very small. Doing it in a very linked and discoverable way. And you're like, oh, linked and discoverable, you just said those words like 40 times. Yes, yes, now you follow it. Good, good. So, we're going to drive a little bit deeper into these examples, and you'll notice that this presentation is actually just a series of deeper dive examples. That linked video list on the right side. So each one of those videos is its own resource. It has its own duration, its own title, its own view count. But looking at this list, it's like, okay, I get that these are all related resources, but why do you know that? It doesn't say, here are some videos. You just kind of look at it and you're like, yeah, there's a video. Really what's happening here is there's kind of three sources of information that they're drawing upon to reach that conclusion. You have context. So you're on YouTube. it's a video site. There are likely a lot of video site-related things here. You wouldn't expect to click something here and get a pie. It doesn't give you pies, it gives you videos. So that's your context. In addition to context, you're going to use semantics. So an example, a really good example on this one actually, is that gear menu up in the video player. A gear has nothing to do with videos. So why is there a gear there? Well, your own semantic knowledge says that gears, it's usually a settings menu. You don't open that to get a gearbox, that's ridiculous. So you're using kind of past knowledge and context, that's your semantics and your context, to figure out what's going on here. Now finally, there's a third source of information, which is just information presented on the page. So I previously said, you know, it doesn't say list of videos. But there's this weird gray line here, which, because contrast, you can barely see, but it's below the first video in case you cannot see it. It doesn't actually tell you what that line is. With your context, you can't really know what that line is. With your semantic knowledge, you don't really know what that line is. And that's where a third source of information comes in, which is just information presented on the page. Up next, that's what that video is. It's just the next video.
There's also a rule of thumb. No, when you see that those gray lines, you have seen them before in similar context.
Also, that's also a very good point, actually. So, that's a good point. I could say that gray line is also semantic knowledge, depending on where you're coming from. So, there are other applications, certainly, where you might divide a view based on lines like that, and it might mean something. So, yeah, that's a good point. So, now at this point, maybe you may not be quite at the hypermedia stage. But maybe you're a little bit more, okay, so it's a way of representing data that's linked and discoverable, it draws on context, it draws on semantic knowledge, and where those two aren't adequate, you include a little bit of extra information. So, now that we've learned a little bit about hypermedia, don't worry, we'll get back to it. It's cool. We're going to immediately stop talking about hypermedia, and now we're going to start talking about something else. Traditional RESTful APIs. Now, I'm going to assume that many people in the audience have some experience with APIs, whether that's building them from the ground up or you used one once, that's fine. And in case you missed it, APIs are, well, they're a way to interact with things. Things can be genuinely anything. They can be users, they can be videos, they can be whatever. The API represents things, resources, entities, all the same thing. Usually with ways you can, or sorry, with things you can do to things. So, for example, you can fetch a thing, or you can update a thing, or you can delete a thing. And then it will define ways you can do things to things. The slide has the word things on it 5 times, 100 it. That is a little bit more specific, but that's when you get into things like an HTTP API, which uses the HTTP spec, the HTTP verbs to define the ways you can do things to things. Now that I've said the word thing about 1,000 times, this might look a little bit familiar to some people. So this is just a normal, traditional REST, well, not really a real REST request, but it's kind of a vague version of one. We're, in this case, using the HTTP GET verb to fetch some user ID 12 in this case, from a host, and the response is application.json. Neat. That should look somewhat familiar. If it doesn't, okay. Feel free to ask questions, that's totally fine. I'm going to be moving at breakneck pace. So the advantages of that approach, and as anybody that's ever used these sorts of APIs is, or designed them more particularly, you're leveraging the HTTP spec. So you may not realize it, but you're actually getting a huge amount of context and semantic knowledge from the HTTP spec. So verbs and routing and response codes, all of those things are giving you a lot of information that you can use that you don't have to kind of redefine on your client. So let's say you have an app, and the app fetches a user, much like that example we just saw. If you fetch your user from that URL and you get back a response code 200, you're good. That's defined by the spec. 200, okay, you're done. This may not seem like that much of an advantage, but if you've ever used an API that doesn't follow these sorts of things and instead says, every time you request something, it will return a 200, and then when you do that, you have to look in the response for the response code field, which may contain other information. Don't do that, but there are APIs that exist like that, and it's really annoying because you have this spec that defines what 200 means, and they explicitly ignore it and do their own thing. Please don't do that. But because you're leveraging HTTP, you actually get a lot of context and context and semantic information based on your request and response. So that's pretty nice. In addition to that, it's very flexible. Like HTTP APIs are used for everything. You define your own routes, you define the resources they're representing, you define everything. There's not really a strong, I'm gonna say a controversial thing, there's not really a right way to make a REST API. There's wrong ways, but there's no one right way, so it's very flexible. In particular, you may appreciate that if you work with RPC or older SOAP APIs, where these sorts of things are not necessarily there, and you may take them for granted if you've never hit something like that before. There is a drawback to this. So REST, as a representational state transfer. In a lot of APIs, the state transfer is minimal at best, or just not there at all. So if you have some resource, let's say a YouTube video, what an interesting, a user. Wrong example. Let's say you have a user. Then you fetch the user. All you know is what's in that response. You don't know anything else about that user's state. So say, for example, this user has a bunch of preferences, like whether they use the night mode or the day mode in your app. It's not there. You don't know that. It tells you their name and something else maybe, but it may not tell you that. Maybe there's a whole bunch of state in your application that is not being included in this response. How useful is that? That's not great. So that's one downside. We'll obviously come back to this. There's a lot of coming back to things in this presentation. We'll come back to this in a bit. That can be overcome, obviously, by in your app, you fetch a user, and then you say, well, if I want to get the user settings, I just go to user/12/settings or whatever. But that solution brings us to another drawback, which is that there's a very strong connection between your client and your server. So the API contract states that, you fetch your users here, you fetch your preferences here. If you move your preferences where they're located, well, you've just broken all your clients. Good job. So anybody that's ever tried to deprecate an API route knows the following. Try to remove a REST API route, you're gonna have a bad time. Because it's very hard. You will always have that one client that's still using version 0.0.1 of your API. You've removed all the other clients using it, but you can't remove it because you have one client still on. That's a downside. You have a strong connection between your client and your server. If you change something on your server, it could very easily have negative consequences on your client. Now, obviously, you could do something like versioning and all that kind of stuff. That's a lot of overhead. It'd be nice if you didn't have to go through all that.
One question.
Yes.
Can have that overhead only for one user who is not compliant. So if we manage to get the majority of users on board with the new structure, then it's okay to have a lot of overhead for the one person who's not compliant.
For sure. And I mean, you can always just say, We're shutting down
We provide a fallback, but doesn't matter how much overhead that it has, it's okay to have it only for one user.
Wouldn't it be nice if you didn't have to have the overhead? Wouldn't that be great, though? If you could make these sorts of changes without having the overhead. I agree. It's nice to support all clients. You can also take the approach of, we're no longer supporting this version. You can either update or it will stop working. That's an option too. It's a little bit more heavy-handed. But there is another option, which, trivia. If you guess this, you don't get any points, by the way. The whole presentation is about this. Like, it's pretty obvious that I was leading back to this. So the good thing about the hypermediate approach to REST, but it is still REST for the record. The good thing about it is that it does still leverage HTTP, so you get all the same benefits of using different verbs and the routing and response codes. It does still have the same flexibility. There's no real guidelines that you have to adhere to. You can do whatever you want for the most part. But one advantage of it is that it does a lot better job of transferring state via related entities, usually or links. So for example, that YouTube example we looked at, when you fetch the video resource, you also get related video. You also get the creator. You also get a link to your profile. So you get all this related information. Now, obviously, it is completely infeasible to transfer the entire state to your client. You because if I fetched a single video from YouTube, that would also then fetch me the state of every video on YouTube, and that would be a very big response. So don't do that. But the idea is that you can include related state, closely related state in your responses that may be helpful to your clients. The possible downside to this is that you do need these magical smart clients. The second disadvantage that I mentioned about traditional REST being the strong contract between client and server, the good thing about that is that your clients can be kind of dumb. All they have to do is call some path with some verb and they get back a response, and they know how to deal with the response because you told them how to deal with the response. So it's pretty simple in that respect. But if you're leveraging a more media approach, you suddenly are faced with this problem of your clients need to be a lot smarter. That's not insurmountable, it's actually very surmountable. But we'll get more at that in a second. So we're going to look at a very quick comparison of traditional REST. Yes, there's a slight Mortal Kombat on this. It's very subtle, I don't know if you notice it. I'm going to take a little look at an example here. So I'm still a lot hand-wavy things at this point. Hopefully, maybe this will start to make things a little bit more concrete. So with my dumb traditional REST client, if I wanted to update a user, well, hard-coded in the client is to update a user when the user taps the edit button on their profile or whatever it is. They put in their new information, they hit save. When they hit save, well, I do a put request to this API with this user ID. The client knows that. It's all hard-coded into the client. That seems very simple. Because it is. That is easy. The downside to that is that what if you're in there doing some refactoring and you're like, you know what, patch. Patch is the new hotness. I'm going to change this route here to use patch. So you go in, you change your routing, and you say, when I patch to example.com/users with an ID, that updates the user. And you broke your clients. Good job. Then you go home for the day because it's somebody else's problem now. So that's not great. I've not been in this field for years, but, you know, breaking clients, bad. So what if there was a better way to do that? There is. With the same approach on with the same problem on Hypermedia, we instead take a more semantic approach. So rather than saying, well, I have to put something to this specific URL with this specific field, all of which is hard-coded in my client, your client can instead be taught to understand the semantics of your application. So they would instead do the update user action, whatever that is, to the update user URI, wherever that is, and including the fields it requires, whatever those are. It sounds very hand-wavy, but if you could teach your client to understand the update user action, understand the update user URI, and understand the fields it requires, then your client is a lot more resilient to change. For example, if I wanted to switch to patch, doesn't matter. So the action now uses patch, whatever. The client's not looking for a method, it's looking for the update user action. So it doesn't break your client. I know I've been in this field for that long, but not breaking your clients is good. It's a good idea. Once again, we're gonna go with the theme of more and more specific examples. It's basically this whole presentation. So in this case, I online magical smart hypermedia client. First thing I do is I hit the root. That's the git slash there. That's usually the way we approach these sorts of things. You just kind of start at the root. That root response comes back with the resource you requested. So say that user comes back with related resources. So maybe it comes back with all the settings already filled in. That's an embedded resource in that response. Cool, now you got the settings too. It might be links to other things, there might be actions, user action, it's all included in that response. So obviously the response is bigger, but it has a lot more of the state of the application, meaning your client doesn't need to know all that information beforehand. It's being sent to it in the response. In this case, oh, that says most. That should have said patch. In this case, it's going to patch to a specific URL to update it, which it didn't know beforehand. In fact, it doesn't even really know now. All it knows is there's an action, it's an update user action, it has some parameters and stuff, just shove those back to the server, and the user is updated. That's all it really knows. Okay, now, for the people that really like details, here is some JSON. All right. So what this is an approximate, simplified, sanitized version of actual admin you were using in G12. It's very wordy, you'll notice. And I'll get back to that later on. So what we have here is, let's say this is our user response. Let's say this is our user response from that user's service. Well, hey, we have my name, we have my age, that's clearly wrong. We have a profile image embedded in there, we've got some actions, we've got some links. All of this related state that I keep waving my hands about. So that's cool. I mean, we have all this information. I mean, it's not really apparent why this is useful yet, because if I just want to display my name, that's a lot of other stuff in there that I don't really care about. But again, and you'll hear me say this so many times, we'll come back to that later. In addition to this response, you know, we got these actions and links. So for example, our update user action. Now this is a very concrete example of what I've been describing with the update user example. Sorry, the update user action. So it's got the name, update user. That is all your tenant or your client knows. That's the only information you need to know, is update user. Obviously, you need to know how to use this action, but that usually is library-ified, so it's not client-specific. This includes the method, the update user URI, or how you go, includes the fields. So by doing this action, which I'll put in quotes, your client can update your user. It didn't know any of this information beforehand except for update user. That's all you need to hard code. The advantage of this, in case it's not apparent, is that the concept of updating a user is a very semantic concept. It doesn't really change over time. The implementation details may change. Maybe you use a totally different coding, or you need, or sorry, different type, or now your users are hosted on the Pirate Bay .org. That don't do that, but it's possible. Like, it doesn't matter where they are because the client doesn't care. You can change that, and the client doesn't break. So that's one of the resilient parts of this, is that unless your semantic concepts change, your clients generally don't break. So that's nice. And then finally, we have links. And links are exactly what they sound like. They're like those videos we saw on the right side of the YouTube screen up there. They're just links to other things that the server thinks might be related. It's very much up to you what you think is related. In this case, we've got a user. Let's say it's an LMS user. I'm not biased for my examples here or anything. A user might have a list of classes they're enrolled in. They got some settings. They got themselves. And then there's a link back to the root of the API. That's just kind of a convention. It's not mandatory or anything. So these are all other resources, other entities that exist in the application, but they're all part of the same state of the application. We've just decided not to include them in this response because eventually your response is going to get very large if you try to include everything. So, what's next? Right, sorry. Back to this slide. Say, for example, we want to have a tab in our magical app that I really haven't described, but a tab that lists my enrollments. So it's got a list of all my classes on it. My workflow here, well, it's the same as I started initially, where I go to the root, that brings me back to the root response. Let's say the root response has a link to the user, we then fetch the user. The user has his enrollments link, cool, now I've got my enrollments. With the hypermedia approach here, all three of those steps required no intimate knowledge of the details of how it's implemented. It was purely based around, well, say you're fetching enrollments, look for the enrollments link. Rel in this case is short for relation. It's just a format that we use. All you do is fetch the enrollments link. There you go. Like with update user, enrollments, the concept doesn't really change. So even if where this is located changes, doesn't matter. It doesn't break your clients. Once we fetch those enrollments, we then, you know, we get back a list of enrollments, and then we kind of start the cycle again. So we've got these all these embedded, or sorry, linked entities with not the information contained in the actual response. Instead, we decided, no, we're going to just give you a link to where it is, and then it's up to the client to follow the exact link for that enrollment. This does mean more trips to the server. The advantage of this is, say you're doing something clever where you're only lazy loading data as you need it. Well, if you're only displaying the first three enrollments, what's the point in fetching all 5,000? Just fetch them as you need them. So in this case, you know, you get this response, it's got 15 enrollments in it, but you're only displaying the first three until the user scrolls down. That's fine, fetch those three, populate the data. When they scroll down, fetch the next three. So you can really kind of just put off loading things, which is good. So hopefully at this point I've kind of sort of slightly clarified what I'm talking about when I talk about aggregate. I'm going to take a brief pause here and see if there are any questions before I move on.
Just to make sure I understand
correctly. Yes.
In REST, you have to know the service, you have to know the service provider, and you have to know the API. In hypermedia, you still have to know the service, you have to know the service provider. The API, you do something that if the service provider changes the API, your code still works.
Yes.
That's the only difference, right?
I should have just said that sentence instead of done this whole presentation, because basically you just described exactly what it is. so to reiterate a little, the idea is that your client isn't aware of the specifics of your API, it's aware of the semantics of your API. And because semantics change so much less often, or may change so much less often than specifics, it's more resilient to change. And I was going to follow up with something else, and I've already forgotten what it was. Yes. As an anecdote that kind of drives home that point, coding something, say an app, that uses an API, usually you're going to have the API, you know, example.com/docs. That's open in one tab. You don't even really need that to make hypermedia client anymore. Asterisk, depending on the API, but the API generally does a much better job explaining itself to you in its response. So with the user's example, I'll go back a few slides, that's good. Let's go backwards in presentation, but I'm doing it. With this example, you don't really need documentation to tell you what this means. Like, it's pretty obvious. It's an update user, and you include some fields here, which name, I know what a name is, I know what an age is. I don't really know what a version is, but it doesn't actually matter. As a sort of side note here, we generally follow the practice of filling in these values with the existing values, so that if you blindly do an action with the given values, it probably won't change the state.
But if the service provider requires a parameter that was not in the parameter value that previously known, we still have to update the client, right?
So these are coming back. This is the response from the server in this case. So
no, I'm general. But the server needs a parameter from the client.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not defined in the first implementation, the first version. Then it's something totally new that the client needs to be updated regardless whether they use REST or hypermedia.
Yeah, that is true. So in that case, what will likely happen is your client may not support that new functionality. So if, for example, I've now got an address field in the update user. So a client that doesn't have an edit field for address, in this case, it wouldn't actually be a problem because usually we just add an address field down at the bottom, pre-populated with my current address. If the client understands what that is, it'll show an edit field for the address. If it doesn't understand what that is, it just doesn't show it. So the client does need to be updated to get the new features, but it also won't break based on the new features. So yeah, that is a good point. Yes?
So APIs, there's like so many different types of APIs,
yes.
And your design will be kind of specify what kind it is. So for example, you can have a web server that's giving you user data and user actions, and maybe one of your clients is an Android app. That has a certain update cycle or to fix basically a bad app version, you have to wait for a new update to occur. Do you have any kind of like, what's the scope of the clients that we're generally talking about for this presentation? Is it generally web clients? Are we actually talking about maybe a binary like an app that is hard to update?
All
types of clients?
Well, yeah, I mean, a lot of the Hyper-V applications we've used have been, there's been some server-to-server ones, some that are client-server, as well as like browser-client kind of thing, as well as some apps, so like Android and iOS apps that use Hyper-V and are aware of Hyper-V. We've been able to add features and slightly change things. As far as I know, without issue, we don't have anybody from the Pulse team directly here, but as far as I know, we didn't break them. I'm getting a no from Owen, and a similar level of indifference from Carol. So, yeah, so it does work. Kind of building off what this gentleman said, thank you. Your clients may not have the new functionality available, but they shouldn't break unless you've done something horrible. Just tell people horrible things. How hard is that?
Isn't repeated trips to the server a weakness of Hypermedia?
How convenient that you bring that up, as it leads me so perfectly into, hey, the downsides part of this. I'm pretty sure the best way to... we've never met each other. The best way to wrap up the presentation is always talk about the bad stuff, because that way people go home remembering all the bad stuff. Like, maybe you should have restructured this, but oh well. So now that hopefully you have an overview of what Hypermedia is, it seems like people are picking up on it. Yeah, now let's talk about why it sucks in some respects. The first one that always comes up is not actually the responses, but that's the next one, don't worry. It's fine. The first one that comes up is the responses are huge. They are. There's no way around that. They are much larger. So in this example, in my app, I'm displaying the user's name. And I got back about 3 billion kilobytes of data, which I don't need. It's like, great. So two things about that. Number one, have you considered gzipping all your problems away? A lot of this data is actually repeated. So once you gzip it, it doesn't shrink down to the 18 characters that is my name, but it does shrink it down pretty substantially in a lot of contexts. The other consideration is that if you're transferring a whole bunch of useless data, maybe you need to rethink things a little bit. And that's where a lot of the hand-wavy and experience parts of this come in, where if you're transferring a bunch of state that isn't useful to any of your clients, maybe consider not transferring that state. So you can shrink your responses back in. They're still bigger. That's a totally valid downside. It's a totally valid concern, but there are ways to mitigate it. That's what you just said. And also, yes. Yeah. That is also true. The downside to building a state like this is that you can't fetch the whole state at once. Now, ideally, it would actually only be one request. You would fetch the state of the application. All of it. Obviously, that's not going to work. See, responses are huge. Your response would be the entire state of some massive application, which is not practical. So instead, you do have to break it up. And in the case of the enrollments example I was talking about, you fetch the root, and then you fetch the user, and then you fetch the list of enrollments, and then you fetch each enrollment. That's 4 hops. That's not great. Yep. Yes, it's caching. No. Gee, it's funny you should ask that. That definitely not a plant. We've never met before. This man that I sit next to, I've never met him before. So yes, that is one way to certainly mitigate that, is caching. Your root response, for example, very unlikely that's going to change. I mean, maybe it does once in a while, but if you crank up the cache time on that, you're doing it once every hour, day, something like that. So if you're caching all this information, you have more requests up front. But again, mitigate. In addition, have you considered HTTP2 to put the problems away? This is not a talk about HTTP2, but we did recently enable it on some servers, and it was very cool. One of its big advantages is that you can bundle requests and do them all in one hop, round trip. The example with the enrollments, that really helped us actually, because we do approximately the workflow that I was illustrating there, where we fetch the root, and then the something, and then we fetch the enrollments. And fetching all the enrollments, you know, if you're displaying a grid of 25 enrollments, is 25 requests, which is a lot. But with HTTP2, it's actually one. So there's more, I guess there's more computational overhead there, but yeah, it's another mitigation strategy. So yes, there are more hops. Yes, that's a downside. But caching can be HTTP2. Yes.
How about Facebook GraphQL? They say they solved this problem.
Ogden's happy because he asked about this earlier. Yes, I've actually had a brief conversation with a coworker about this because somebody introduced me to GraphQL and was like, why don't we use GraphQL? And the conclusion we sort of reached is that they're not mutually exclusive. The idea we came up with that we have not implemented and maybe totally infeasible, but hey, let's talk about it anyway, would be to have a similar representation of data, but use GraphQL to define the embedding and the linking that you use. So if you know your application needs your user and all your enrollments, instead of saying, say, fetching user, then when that comes back, you fetch your enrollments list, and when that comes back, you fetch all your enrollments, if you can GraphQLify it and say, fetch me my user's enrollments and embed them, and then send that, and you can still get back a very similar response to what we just saw, but already filled out with all the data. Disclaimer, not tested. We have no idea if that makes sense or if it'll work, but it was an idea that we talked about for like 12 minutes, so that makes it valid. David, raise your hand a moment ago.
Well, I was just going to say, if your web app is a single page app, so this is an advantage that Facebook and Twitter as modern apps, they're single page apps, they never reload as you click around. So that kind of minimizes the multiple requests. You do a few requests when the page first loads, but then as you're clicking around, it's just loading basically different.
Yeah.
One more.
And you may have seen that sort of thing on, that was going to be a very specific example. On some web pages, they'll be like reload to refresh or refresh to reload kind of thing. And that is part of that where they already have the data, then they fetch it in the background, but that's, I guess, not strictly related to what we're talking about. But it's cool too. Hello?
Hi. So could you use Angular? Because that's basically for single page applications.
Yeah, the two technologies I would say are orthogonal. You can absolutely use them together. We do have a case where we're using, it might be React. Either way, it still applies. We have a React app that uses Hypermedia APIs. So the React is used for the React things, and then the Hypermedia is used for all the data fetching backend stuff. And they
seem to work fine because the app works fine.
So, yeah, there's nothing to say that you can't use Angular at all. I've never used it, but it's more of the
you can define services and stuff like that to define your entry points, and then your entity you can refresh it based on the
thank you. Thank you, audience, for answering questions that I don't know the answer to. That sounds sarcastic, but I actually appreciate it. Thank you. Right, yes. Open comms. Here's another disadvantage that people like to bring up.
So those are the two big ones. This one comes up all the time too.
It's really hard to read this stuff. It's just like a bunch of funny squiggly brackets and stuff. And again, you're right, but you know what? So is code. If you took some C# and went to a letters office and were like, here, they'd be like, what is this? Similarly, if a lawyer came to me and gave me a legal document, I'd be like, yeah, it's hard to read, but it's just a format. You get over it. Honestly, with a decent JSON format or extension in your browser, I'd much prefer these sorts of APIs because instead of having the API doc open on one side and you're constantly changing the path in your URL and trying to find what you're trying to find things, you just click stuff. It's kind of nice. Formats all the links as links. You just click the link and it takes you to the next thing. Pretty slick. So not a huge concern. And then finally, the most interesting downside in the world. It's hard to document. And yes, asterisk. The asterisk being, you're also kind of missing the point. It's not that you don't need to document a Hypermedia API, it's that they try to be as self-documenting as possible. The difference, of course, is that you're not documenting specifics anymore, you're documenting semantics, which can be hard but I think it's hard purely based on it's not what we normally do. So anybody that writes documentation is used to speaking in the language of specifics, where you have a route that takes a verb that responds with a thing, and the thing has a format. In the case of hypermedia, you're not defining those sort of specifics anymore. You're defining things more like, what does the update user action mean? What does it mean to be a user? What does it mean to be a collection of things? So you've got a much more linguistic API doc, I suppose. So it's not that it's necessarily hard to document, it's just that it's different. It's differently documented, put it that way. But yeah, again, one of the main advantages here is that they're a little more self-describing as well, so documentation is lesser. I'm not gonna lie, we don't have a whole lot on some of our new hypermedia APIs. We should probably have more. Thus far, we're only using them internally, so it's not that big of a concern, but it also hasn't been that big of a push, because a user is pretty obvious what a user is. It's a user. Yes?
I want to go back to the responses are huge as a down, well, as a problem with the client.
Yes.
I'm looking at this as more of a problem with the server, because there are some services that have millions of users, you know, very, very heavy load on them. Mm-hmm. Now, we not only add to the problem by them having to provide large response for every single request, but they also ask, okay, the client wasn't the one to reduce the load on the network, you have to GCP it as well. Mm-hmm. So imagine what the load would be on server. So is that going to be a problem? Because the actual size may not be as big a problem since you passed the era of dial-up. But the processing power required for that to service millions of users, that should be a problem.
It is. It is certainly a non-trivial concern, especially with the GSIP thing, yeah. There are, again, kind of mitigation methods, right? Where because if you're leveraging a lot of caching and you're doing a lot of smart things, there you go with that quote, like that, then you're going to reduce your server load by that method. But if you just straight up took an application that has a REST API and converted everything straight to an hypermedia API, yeah, you'd probably run into some problems. You also run into issues with data representation, where, as a little anecdote, we explored this concept of an embedding depth, where if you say have, I'm not gonna go back to that, I don't remember what slide. you had the list of enrollments, and instead of including the enrollment information, it just had a link to the enrollment. We did explore some options about embedding the information right in it, but you quickly get to this, you can very quickly get to that state I was talking about where you're embedding the entire state of YouTube in response. And not only is that a huge response, it's also massively expensive to create. And that's absolutely true, where if I'm fetching a whole ton of data and filling it all in, I'm going to be hitting who knows how many tables, and maybe some of those bits of information are actually over a network, and so you end up with slow responses and huge responses. So with the other downsides, the answer is, yep, that is true.
So no, the conclusion would be it has its uses, but we have to be selective when we implement.
Yes.
When we implement.
Yeah, and I actually forgot to say that at the beginning of this presentation. What you're doing today isn't wrong. I'm not here to tell you you're wrong. This is just an option. Although Dave had a response, I think.
I was just going to say, so if your existing API is returning millions of users, chances are it has a similar problem. But there's lots of mechanisms you can use. So instead of returning a collection that has a million entries, you return a page collection. So maybe it just returns 10 with a link to the next 10, with a link to the next 10, or 100, or however many you want to do. So there's lots of ways. If you have millions of objects, that maybe instead of returning a collection, it's more of a search. So you make users search instead of returning everything.
Oh,
also that.
Yeah, but it depends. If we want one thing and we get 1 million, the one thing that we want maybe on the millionth page, on the thousandth page, right?
Yeah. It's definitely something that has caused a couple problems. And we've found solutions that work for us, for most of them.
But like any technology, you have to find usage case that fits this technology,
yes.
The technology fits them.
Yeah.
It solves many problems for certain problems, not good for every problem.
True, yeah, and in the case of the enrollments thing, it was kind of at odds with the data architecture. You have highly distributed data spread across many, many tables, so filling in all this information would have been very expensive. So in order to mitigate that, we did what I previously mentioned and combined with what David said, where we used paging and we're only giving you a small amount of data. It's up to the client to fetch more data if it wants it. So we're being as lazy as possible on the server, which does mean more client hops, but then that comes back to the second point here, which also can be mitigated. So yeah, there are certainly downsides. Yes, is the response to most of these downsides. They all exist.
Document.
Oh my god, nice. Whoa. Spoil the surprise. So that kind of concludes the me talking at you part of this, which is good because my mouth is extremely dry now. But hopefully I've kind of driven home what some of the advantages are here. We have something that is a more semantic approach to APIs, which helps in it being more discoverable and which helps in it being more resilient to change. That's kind of the summary of it. Now, as pointed out several times by several people, there are obviously downsides. We've encountered many of them. Thus far, we've been able to overcome most of them. There are still some questions we have, still some quirks, but it's a fairly new thing not just for D2L, it's a fairly new thing to everybody. So. We're learning every day. Hello, Bob.
Here a question for you. How do you deal with if you have a defined data structure, intermediate creates the relationships. Where in the relationships used to live in the client, now it lives in the server to know different entities to find or to embed. Have you done embedding of entities? And if so, how do you deal with relationship breaking? So if I have a TV show and I have episodes as my entities, if I wanted to do TV show season episodes, what kind of strategies would you recommend applying to those things? Because you're essentially breaking the relationship, and if your client is a dumb client, they would probably be looking up based off rels or some sort of mapping, whatever you choose to do. So how do you deal with that? How do you have to deal with that?
I haven't, I don't think. So in that case, you are making it's almost like an additive, reductive change, where you've removed one thing but added another. I guess, gracefully speaking, your app client would just be there are no episodes, because it's not looking for the seasons, it's looking for episodes. That's the crappiest
way to handle it. Purely adding is okay too, right? So you could add a new relationship without removing episodes. Keep it there, and then just add seasons that have episodes.
If you're in
that,
eventually
you
change your client
and switch over. You'd never be able to remove episodes. Or you would eventually, years later.
Yes, I'm going to reiterate what you just said, because I forgot this whole time I was supposed to be handing people microphones so the recording can hear too. I'm sorry. We're going to have to do this whole thing again. Okay. I'm kidding. I just did the worst thing possible. Okay.
It is working.
You happy now?
Yeah.
I'm fine. The people watching this recording won't be. To reiterate Pogdick's question, what happens in the example you've got a TV show app? You go from listing TV shows, now you push them down by a layer. Instead of listing TV shows, you list seasons, which then have the TV shows or the TV episodes. Good solution Dave gave was just add them all as another thing. So in terms of deprecation, we have yet to deal with deprecation. I've had some thoughts about it, but we've never had to implement it. In theory, if you have a smart client, you just described, you used the words dumb client in that question. I said right at the beginning, magical smart client. Not even listening. I'm really scared of that now. But if you have a magical smart client, maybe it's a smart client that understands the concept of a deprecated class or something. So
if you're planning to deprecate an action or a link or something, you could just add a class onto it. Classes are just kind of tags that's deprecated, and then so your smart client is like, okay, I know this won't be here in a future version. I will send an email to the creator of this app or something like that. We haven't yet had to deal with straight up removing stuff. That's not true. We did once, but it went okay because of reasons, but not interesting reasons. So, yeah. It's a good question, and the answer is just keep making your responses bigger. That's not a very good answer. Oh, there's another question. But for this one, I will hand him a microphone. Thank you. I don't want to walk in front of the speakers because I just know that's going to go badly.
You were saying... Sorry, I'm here.
You're good.
Okay. You were saying that when you were embedding lots and lots of entities, the message was getting huge?
Yeah.
What was the limiting resource on servers when that was happening?
Good question, actually. So in the case of our high embedding, we were hitting some not-so-performant like Sparks and stuff that kind of didn't do so well, which I tried to change and then was told don't change those. So we just kind of stopped using that. We still use the embedding in a couple places, but largely speaking, especially with the HTTP2 improvement, it's become less important-ish, where doing the extra hop is mostly okay because we're doing many fetches at once. So it's, yes, it's one more hop to get that information that would otherwise be embedded in one hop, but because we don't need it in all cases, it is nicer on the server. We like to be nice to the server.
We also found that in the case of embedding, you're then thwarting your caching strategy, because including things in your collection, then you know you can't cache the collection as well as you can the individual entity. So you could have a very smart client that says, I'm going to go through the collection and pull out the resources and cache it under that URL or something. But yeah, we found non-embedding just allowed us to use standard HTTP client caching. And yeah.
Totally forgot about that. But that is also good. Yes. Yeah, so several slides back, there was a link, the self link. And we generally use that as an ID that refers to the resource itself, which, as Owen just described, doesn't work if you're embedding things because you have a self link on the outermost entity, but then as you embed things further and deeper, they too may have self links, but you're not necessarily caching them unless you've given me a good idea about this uber smart client that goes through the collection and caches everything. Magic. Yes. Hopefully that kind of didn't answer your question at all and instead just told you to make things bigger.
Yeah. Hello? I have a question.
Oh, wait. Microphone.
Is there anything you should steer clear of that it's just a bad idea for hypermedia to be used, or it's so many cases you have to worry about it's not worth doing?
Yes. I've mostly been doing a lot of hypermedia stuff lately, so no specific example, but a theoretical example that I'm going to make up right now. If you have like a hyper simple service and it's just like post telemetry events to this endpoint, probably doesn't need to be hypermediaified. Like, if all you do is post stuff to an endpoint and it says 200 or good or 204 or whatever, probably not much point there. Your response code is enough to get the information across. There isn't really a state. So something like that, yeah, there's no point in hypermedia. I'm sure there are other cases as well where it's either, as you brought up, either, you know, these large responses are gonna have a negative impact on what you're doing and can't be mitigated somehow. That's possible. I don't know. So yeah, there are
maybe like a low memory footprint embedded system or something.
Or that, yeah. Your microwave probably doesn't have hypermedia.
New functionality.
I mean, maybe.
Internet of Things microwave.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
The Internet of Microwave.
Can I tack on again?
Yes.
Cool. I think one of the other things we identified as being a downside for some hypermedia usage is some of those server-to-server cases. So, for instance, in the context of D2L. If you were integrating with a school and all they really wanted to do was be able to import all the information about their students and which courses they're in and you know what courses they're not allowed to be in, et cetera, you know, that in that case, that's where you desire a super stable API that regardless of whether you wanted to change it, you can't really, because that's the core business and you just need it to go fast and you don't need all this fancy other stuff.
Yeah.
So in that very like server-to-server case where you, regardless of, you know, through a contract that you sign with the client, you have a very stable API anyway. And so those were cases where we found, you know, the quote-unquote overhead of Hypermedia it isn't worthwhile in that case.
Yeah, that's a very good point. And we have had server-to-server cases where we did use it, but I think at least one of them I'm thinking of was just because one of those servers was also used by a client app. So we maybe didn't need to do it in that case, but we did it because one of them was already Hypermedia anyway. Yes, ma'am.
So I build a lot of UIs, and one of the most annoying things I've found about building UIs against traditional REST. Like you said, you've got the routes hard coded, you've got all the stuff you have to pass them hard coded, which really sucks. But sometimes also just finding out if the user can do something. So for example, can I even edit my profile? Can I even see your profile? Those types of questions are really difficult, and so you often find the API, the traditional REST, returning booleans like can edit true, can view false. Could you talk maybe a bit? Here's an LED for
you. Thank you. Wouldn't get the update action in that case.
Right. So how does Hypermedia?
Yes. What a totally open-ended question. Doesn't that all sound scripted? But actually wasn't. That is a really great example too. And in fact, there was a little bit of a horror story that I heard about this way back at the beginning when I started at D2L, where in order to find out if a user could edit something, the client app had to try to edit it, and then if it got back a 403, it would be like, can't edit that.
It was uploading files.
What's that? Uploading files, sorry. So it had to actually attempt to do the action before knowing whether it could do the action. So in the case of Hypermedia, you just don't include the update user action. So in your client, you say, if update user action, put an update user button. Not there, just don't put it there. So it is, and that's kind of part of the application state representation where the response tells you what you can and cannot do based on itself. Like it is self-descriptive. If something's not there, that either means it doesn't exist or you're not allowed to do it, or possibly it just wasn't included for one of a myriad of other reasons, but we're not gonna talk about this. So, but yes, thank you for that extremely, whatever it was, but you used a sports word.
Alley-oop,
thank you. Oh, I just realized we're on the questions, comments, concerns, and origami part of this presentation. In case somebody that's here is just not paying any attention, it's just a folding origami. I actually have been. I'm very good at it. This whole time I was folding origami, you didn't know this, but I made a T-Rex. That's completely a lie. I didn't even make that. Oliver, I mean, person who I've never met before.
Hi. So, who else uses Hypermedia?
People.
I asked because I've never heard of it before.
Yeah.
And with API design, there's a big thing of like, they're designed to be used.
Yes.
And if no one understands what Hypermedia is, they're gonna have a difficulty and they'll have to watch this video, this great video of Hypermedia.
Once dropped the mic. I was seeing a good
mic. Accidental mic drop the mic. So I guess my question is, like, that's fine if it's internal API. So if you're a company and you've decided Hypermedia is the best way to build APIs, that's great, because now you've decided what's great and everyone else will learn.
Yeah, but who else wants to do it?
But if you're saying this to external developers, there might be some friction. Have you made any of these Hypermedia APIs for external developers, and how did it go?
Nope, is the short answer.
Okay.
The longer answer is nope, partially because of what you just expressed. So we've been using these internal APIs for going on a year and a half, I think. But we have not yet made them public because kind of that. Hypermedia is a fairly new thing, to the point where actually the response formats you saw, that's just one Hypermedia response format. It's not a standard. In the very beginning, think back many, many minutes ago, my hand-wavy definition about structuring data in a discoverable, linked way, that's pretty much it. So we're using the Siren Hypermedia format. For people maybe using other ones, then there's no standard. There are like helper libraries and all that kind of stuff that help make it easier,
But yeah, if you were just like, in order to interact with a service, here's this really confusing response. Do you know what hypermedia is? No, too bad. Great for the client-server, client-company relations. So no, we haven't made anything public yet, and that's kind of why. Oh, it has a follow-up.
Yeah, in terms of the company names, no. But if you want to have some terms to search for, Ryan has said one of them thus far is Siren.
Oh,
this format we're using, this format, which is why we chose to use it. If you want to search for other things, there's HAL, just H-A-L. We might want to add hypermedia onto that if you want to find something on Google. there's a collection plus JSON, I believe, is another one of them, and then probably
libraries.
Yeah.
Companies library, like sorry.
I don't have specs. Not necessarily like IETF defined RFCs, defined descriptions of ways to format them.
So implementations of hypermedia.
Yeah. Then as well, one of the well-known ones is JSON-LD, which is used by, for instance, IMS is a standards provider within the educational space, and all their newer stuff is going towards JSON-LD. JSON-LD was originally defined by, if you want, name drop Google. they actually use JSON-LD on some of their APIs. The action part of that is an extension of JSON-LD, et cetera, et cetera. So there's a lot in the space, lots of companies. You probably have to do some searching if you wanted a list. But yes, it's not unique to D12.
No, we didn't make this all off. I made this all off. This was totally off the top. But yeah, there are people using it, but it is hard to describe.
Mass and momentum.
Not yet. Just
Just it's starting.
It's what? This is it right here. Oh, microphone. I don't want to step in front of the speakers. I'm not lazy. It's going to go bad.
It's just a technique, just a concept. Not you don't actually have a platform or some code. Some kind of framework that support developers.
So we do. Internally, we built some tools for it. I'm sure there are certainly libraries for it out there.
Yes.
I'm pretty sure there's a Java one, a C sharp one, all that kind of stuff. Which make a lot of what looks like it would be a huge pain in the ass a lot easier. So things like, I have this giant Siren response. I want to do the update user action. There are utilities that will be like, Siren response dot do action. Update user dot include fields.
You have tools for both server side and the client.
Yes.
Side.
Yeah. So we.
But they are not public.
I don't think so.
Open source.
They're certainly open source. I don't know if they're public.
So
wait. Yes, they are. Some of them are.
Is there another?
Yes. There's another mic. If you want another mic,
I'll just.
Okay. Just play past the mic.
Yeah.
This is my favorite.
Yeah. So there's a variety of tools. We're following the description of how you can format hypermedia described as Siren. So there is a variety of tools, like I think Ryan said there, I believe there's a Java one. I think there are other ones that we haven't built as well, but like for instance, internally, we have a client one for Android that we use to parse. We have a client one for iOS that we use to parse it. We have a public C# package for parsing and interacting with it, called D12 Hypermedia Siren.
It's great for you.
Do you have anything in pure JavaScript?
So JavaScript, we have some stuff we publish for that. There's also a quote-unquote popular library called Super Siren, which presents a fluent API for traversing Siren. It says starting at this thing, I want to go to users, get user 12, do this like you would just define a flow spec sort of thing. Of 100 links to follow, and at the end it pops you up the entity because it's able to do all the things with all you saying is follow the enrollments link, follow the get the third enrollment, whatever. So the power of describing with semantics means there's a library called Super Siren that just lets you describe the semantics and get stuff done. There are libraries out there for
are they proprietary or available for them?
No, they should all be available. They're all available. Like all the ones we use are, I think they're majority of the open source are GitHub. Some of them aren't.
Yeah. So some of the ones we built are open source. Some of the other ones we use are open source.
Yeah.
There's no JIT. Like
links would have been very helpful. I should have included links.
How would I
find I don't have any links. I'm sorry. The link is google.ca/. No. I should have included links, that's my bad. But there are certainly several out there. They're not as widespread as a lot of more popular technologies, and especially because we have this fragmentation between various formats, and there is no one standard format, just kind of mean the whole. There's 14 competing standards. We need to create one standard that matches all competing standards. Oh, now we have 15 competing standards.
So basically, so, if you code for one, still doesn't communicate with the other.
No, it would not work with the other. So you do need to at least follow the same spec on client and server. Maybe you could create something that works in multiple specs. That sounds like a pain.
That is also say if I create a client that works against the Trello API,
fair
and also it doesn't work against the Twitter API.
That's good. That is valid.
Well, they have to know what you want from the server.
Yes. Yeah.
A tweet or something. Else.
Yeah. 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 Bogdan had his hand up, or he was just rubbing his head.
I am.
You did. Okay.
This is more of a political question. Do you think that hypermediated AI having X number of specs is a downside compared to, let's say, GraphQL, which seems to be gaining a lot more traction compared to hypermediated? And where wrong with your money? because it seems like an HD DVD versus Blu-ray kind of discussion.
I don't know. I don't see them as entirely disjoint. Like, they are certainly somewhat competing. But the idea with I'm not an expert at GraphQL at all. I basically read the first page when you go to like GraphQL.com. Not an expert. But I get the impression that they're not strictly speaking at odds with each other. One of them is a way to, if I'm not mistaken, GraphQL is more of a way to like fetch specific data in a structure that you define. Is that the idea there? With hypermedia, it's, I think, more about the representation of that data. Data fetched with GraphQL could be represented in Siren hypermedia. I don't know if you'd want to do that, as I previously mentioned, 12-minute conversation. Maybe don't just put that in production, or do. So yeah, if I had to pick one, I have more experience with hypermedia. I've been surrounded by it for 2 years, so I have no bias whatsoever, and therefore would say hypermedia. But yeah, I also recognize that GraphQL makes a lot of sense and has, I don't know, there's some big company behind it. I don't know if there's like a social media website. I don't know anything about them, but yeah. So I don't really have a good response. We use hypermedia here. It works well. If we could go back and do it all again, what do you think? Maybe should we switch to GraphQL?
I don't know what
I'm doing. Either. I don't know about the version of it. There's my. Hey, that's even a politician's response. They gave you no good information, but it seems like I answered the question.
My guess is that 2 years from now, there'll be a new thing. Pick something.
Stick with it. Go. It's not going to go anywhere. Maybe it'll still be around. So.
Yeah. That's my question.
Just like so.
Oh,
yep.
God.
Hey, it still exists, so... Yeah.
Tell it already.
We tried. Anyway, if there are no further questions, comments, or origami, I'm sadly disappointed that nobody was doing origami this whole time, then that pretty much concludes this. We have drinks and food out there. If you want drinks and food, go for it. Is that a question? Oh, you're raising your hand in a really weird way. Never mind. But yeah, thus is the summary.